Father, we thank you for your love and your grace at this time. And I pray that you would cause and allow your Spirit to move and minister in this house. We need you. Father, we need you today. We need you to empower us, Lord, as we submit and humble ourselves unto your servants. We need you to empower us as fathers, as mothers, as parents, as siblings, as grandparents, Father, to reach this generation. I pray, Father, that you would save the children. And Father, let this be imposed into our spirit. Let it be impelled into our hearts, Father, that we may do all that is possible by your strength and by your power, that we may save the children, that we may see this generation saved. Father, I ask you to lay this upon our hearts with the strongest conviction. Father, that we cannot not do this. Father, change our heart. Direct us as you direct this ministry, I ask in Jesus' name. My prayer is that God will minister to you through this message. And of course, many of you are here, but there are many that are out this morning. And I'm not so sure that I won't come back with this same set of notes and re-preach this message in a few weeks. At least something very, very, very similar to this. We must see the children saved. It's on our watch. It's on our watch. And when we're at watch, it's not our time to be complacent, go to sleep, or be distracted. It's on our watch. There may not be many things, but there certainly are things in Scripture that too many people bypass or overlook throughout the Scriptures. Here is a short list of things founded in Scripture that many people overlook. Well, one of them is that many people overlook the will and the power of God to heal. I'm not going to preach on this or elaborate this. I'm just stating this to bring out a couple of others and leading to a point that I want to make. Many people overlook the design from God that we should live a sanctified life. And this is one of the reasons that our children are lost and being lost. This is one of the reasons that my generation, by and large, are lost and are being lost. God has called us to live a sanctified life. We're living in a day where I'm hearing, it's a new phrase to me, but where people are literally preaching this concept, though it's not mentioned in the Bible as such as all, but they're preaching a concept as though it's valid and true, and they're calling it hyper grace, that it literally does not matter what you do or say, how you act or behave, that God gives grace no matter what, and you're going to heaven no matter what. And that's not true. The Bible said there's a sin unto death and a sin not unto death. The Bible distinguishes that some sins are abominations. The Bible teaches that we must make Jesus our Lord more so than it stresses accepting Him as Savior. It teaches we must make Jesus our Lord. That means He's master and commander of our lives. The design from God is that we should live a sanctified life, that we should walk uprightly before Him. Now, I'm not ascribing to you that I believe that you have to be perfect. That's where grace comes in. But I am ascribing to you with my lips that you are to endeavor to serve God, to honor Him, to surrender your life. And there's no such thing as what is being referred to as a hyper grace. Grace is granted to those who repent. Amen. You see, God loves the whole world. That's why Jesus came. That's why Jesus died. He'll love you into heaven or He'll love you into hell. He loves the whole world, but He gives grace to those who repent. And He does give favor to the devout. And that's scriptural through and through. I don't have time to linger there. Let me read Jude chapter 4. And this is from the New International Version. It says it like this. He said, for certain men, by the way, when was the last time you read Jude? I mean, that's just a little book. Some people may have overlooked that, may not even know it's there, Jude. It doesn't even have chapters. It has verses. Jude, verse 4. For certain men whose condemnation was written about long ago. You see, those who pervert the gospel, those who lead others wrong, if the blind lead the blind, they both fall into the ditch. And their condemnation was written about long ago. It says, they have secretly slipped in among you. They are godless men, secretly among you, godless men who changed the grace of our God into a license for immorality. They changed the grace. This is where this hyper grace is coming in. And I'm just not trying to linger here, but I believe I'm supposed to make a point here. There are some things in Scripture that too many people overlook. And I've been to so many funerals where the man or woman who laid in the casket and was about to be placed in the ground lived a sinful life full of debauchery and just rebellion against God, yet they were preached into heaven as though they were saints. And the thing of that is, I don't like to judge people. If you can't judge someone for doing wrong, how can you be the judge if they do right, especially when they've lived wickedly before the entire world, before their families, and you tell that family, oh, he went to heaven, it makes the children and the grandchildren think, oh, that means I can do exactly what he did and still go to heaven, when it's not true at all. Are you getting this? Does this make any sense? See, I went into the Hebrew and looked at the word that's translated license for immorality, and I looked in other places where this word is located. Ephesians 4:19, for example, it says, having lost all sensitivity, they have given themselves over, and here's the word, to sensuality. They've given themselves over to sensuality, as though it's okay to be immoral, as though it's okay, as though they have a license for immorality. They have given themselves over to sensuality so as to indulge in every kind of impurity with a continual lust for more. Don't tell me God's going to turn that kind of person into an angel. Amen. I think I changed the culture in Eastland for a little while. Years ago, everybody would preach, whoever was in the casket was being turned into an angel when they got to heaven. That's not scriptural. I believe in being scriptural. I believe in knowing what the Word says, and don't make something up that it does not say. Amen. Who wants to be an angel anyway? The Bible says that we're going to judge angels. Amen. Who wants to be demoted? Many people also overlook that it is God's will to bless and deliver us out of our trouble. Many people, too many people, here's my point I'm leading up to. Too many people also overlook the fact that we are responsible for the next generation. Amen. I really thought when I said that, y'all would give me a standing ovation, shouting me down where I would be unable to preach. Too many people, let it not be of this house. Let it not be of this congregation. Too many people also overlook the fact that we are responsible for the next generation. And this, amen, give him praise. And this is where my heart is today. This is where my spirit is today. God has always chosen the young generations, and I will give you a few examples. Samuel was called as a child. As a small boy, he heard the voice of God. David was a boy, and he killed a giant. God calls the young of their generation. Psalms 8:2, it says this, out of the mouth of babes and nursing infants, you have ordained strength. One translation says you have ordained praise. That's wrong. It's the Hebrew is clear. Most translations or many translations are clear. You know, I think some people who transcribed some of the translations were watering things down because they did not want to empower the people too much. But he said, out of the mouth of babes and nursing infants, you have ordained strength. God is able to call the young, and he does, and God is able to empower them. If God is able to empower them, church, let me ask you, can he not empower us also? And I believe he's trying to empower us so that we can reach this generation. Amen. He called the disciples when they were young themselves. Timothy was a boy called by God. Who brought the fish? Do you remember the feeding of the 5,000? Who brought the fish? In John chapter 6, it tells us it was a boy that brought five small barley loaves and two small fish. I guess it was about enough for him, being an energetic little boy. It was a boy that brought the food that was blessed and multiplied and fed 5,000 men, the Bible says, besides the women and children, and there were 12 baskets left over. Can you imagine if we can reach this generation while they're young and while they're fresh with energy and strength and new faith? Amen. God forbid that we should grow old and lose our faith. God forbid that we should grow old and not have a faith stronger today than when we were young, and enthusiasm greater today than when we were children. Amen. ROL, River of Life, has always endeavored to reach this next generation. We've spent large portions of our time, energy, and resources on children's ministry and youth ministry. It was years ago, a young man in the church, he sold his house, and the equity he got was something like $9,600. He came to me and he said, I want to give you this so you can build a basketball court back here. He felt like it was important to help be a service for young people, to give them a place to gather. And so we did. And one of the men at that time, he was older than me. That was years ago. That's back when I was very, very young. And one of the old men in the church took me out to the outside to look, address the basketball court. He said, why did we build this court? He said, why don't we use that money to feed the hungry? And what he did not realize, because he was unfamiliar with this ministry and he had his own preconceived concepts that we weren't fit and good enough as a ministry, what he did not realize was that we never turned anyone down who was hungry, but we would send them at that time, we would send them to the grocery store and we would follow and pay for their bill. Now God, since then God directed us with the food pantry and we are able to help wonderfully. So this young man gave his $9,600. I told him, I said, no, don't give me the equity from your home. Finally, I came to a point, I said, only give me half and I'll build something out there. And frustrated, he handed me the check. He said, this is what God told me to do. You do what you want to do. Amen. I was proud. That was my oldest son. I was proud of that boy. And later, when it came time for him to buy a house, he trusted God for a bonus that was not due at that time. And he told me how the other two, the sons of the owners of the company, had received $1,200 a piece bonus. And I thought, well, we're trusting God to supply the equity that he gave. And I said, how much do you want? He said, at least twice as much as them, and which still was not enough. And when he got his bonus a few days later, it was $9,400. Amen. $9,400. So, through bus ministry, I appreciate those who drive the shuttle or the vans when we had them. Now we're doing shuttles. I appreciate those who dedicate themselves to go to Ranger and such. I'm praying that God will strengthen our bus ministry as we labor through the summer and fall. I'm about to speak on that. But we always endeavor to be a blessing to the young people. This past Sunday was, and to those who attended both services, it was an incredible day as we ministered to those who graduated from this congregation, and also as we served ministry to the baccalaureate service here. It was an incredible day. In fact, I was told that the principal of the high school said that it was, what was the word? He was amazed. I can't think. It was one of those big words, you know. So our vision is to see that Eastland County is saved in its entirety. And you know, you've heard me preach this for years. Let Eastland County be saved in its entirety. So our mission right now, this summer and fall, for the next several months, and maybe the year, and I don't know where beyond, our mission for the next several months of River of Life Church and maybe a year is to reach and minister to as many children as possible. Amen. To reach and minister to as many children as possible. And we are already in the works of strategizing and planning and setting things forth. I'm just going to say this. We need your help. And I'm asking you for your help. This is the forefront mission. For every vision, you must have mission. This is the forefront mission of this ministry right now, is to reach the children and the youth for Jesus Christ. And they need the Lord. Somebody said, can it be done? Does anyone care? Can it be done? Did you know, when people do not believe that it can be done, they begin to quit caring. It can be done. I want to read this little story. It's entitled A Peep Over the Pale. Some of you remember this from years ago. Sometimes we need just a peep over the pale to get a glimpse and catch the vision, a renewed vision. In his talk entitled, A Peep Over the Pale, Chris Carey explains the importance of insight, perspective, and hope as he told this story. Laboratory researchers immersed a test group of rats in individual buckets filled with water. Their question was, how long can a rat tread water before it drowns? Somebody said, oh, animal cruelty. But there's not a one of you that won't set a trap out if you think you have a mouse, you know. So let's get beyond that for a moment at least. They found that the average rat can struggle to keep its head above water for no more than 30 minutes before it becomes completely exhausted and must be rescued or die. I can't help myself. I have to throw this in. How many times are you going through a trial and in less than 30 minutes you are starting to sink and drown because you have no more tenacity than a rat? Let me tell you, God has called us to a work, and it's time we get a peep over the pale. It's time that we get tenacity and get committed to doing what God has called us to do. But we get beset by my little problem here, my little trouble here, and we get beset just on every time and continually, and we begin to fail doing what God has called us to do because it demands commitment, devotion. So no more than 30 minutes Then it has to be rescued. Then, so they added a peep over the pail. And I hope I'm giving you a peep over the pail. Just as the rat was going down for the proverbial third time, a researcher snatched the rat up by the nape of the neck, providing it with a peep over the pail. In that instant, the rat saw that the whole world was not wet and galvanized and over its head. Then the rat was released back into the water, where it again began to swim for its life. And each time the rat became totally exhausted, someone picked it up and gave it a momentary peep over the pail. This can be done. We can reach this generation. We can save the children. Will anyone help me save the children? So what was the result of this gruesome experiment? The study reported that a rat without hope can drown in 30 minutes. And let me just tell you, we have children that are living without hope. Children that don't know what to do, and they're confused because their parents have been confused and their grandparents have been confused, and all they know is a confused world. I've seen it in our youth ministry, children that were raised in these kind of homes, but yet now through our ministry, they begin to seek God, getting a glimpse or a grasp of hope, knowing that life can be better than what they experienced. It was for a period of time, we would ask young people in our youth group, we would ask, why do you like to come to this church on Wednesday nights? And they would give us repeatedly the same two answers. One, we feel loved, and they were loved. Two, we feel safe. They were talking about the difference of being here or being at their home, and they said, we feel loved and we feel safe. Save the children. Save the children. Let's look at the impossible. Can you pray this prayer with me? Father, give me the heart of Jesus. Can you do that? Can you pray and begin praying and pray earnestly and sincerely? Father, give me the heart of Jesus, and this is what I'm asking of you to do. As members and friends and loyalty to this church, devotion to this ministry, that gets a little confusing. Our devotion is totally to be toward our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. But God calls us, He leads us, He gives us vision and mission. And I'm asking you for this, loyalty to the vision and to the ministry through this ministry. Father, give me the heart of Jesus. I'm not asking for your blood. I'm not asking for your life. But I am asking for your heart. Can you give your heart to the Lord Jesus and for the cause and for the sake, for the vision and for the mission? Save the children. Save the children. Amen. Quit throwing them away. They're not your children, so you don't care. And that attitude only conveys to your children that you don't care about them either. You see, the whole crux of ministry, the whole crux of serving God is about forgiveness and love and compassion. And when we begin to lose compassion for others and love for others, and we begin to lose our care and our concern for others, we're losing the whole purpose that Jesus died for. In Malachi 4 and verse 6, it says, He will turn the hearts of the father to the children. So I ask, fathers, pray this to your father. Give me the heart of Jesus. He said he will turn the hearts of the fathers to the children. The reason he says this is because he's speaking of a time when the fathers are turned from the children. That he will turn the hearts of the fathers to the children and the hearts of the children to the fathers. He said, or else I will come and strike the land with a curse. And today our land is suffering a curse, not only in America but around the world. We're suffering a curse because fathers' hearts are not turned toward the children. Amen. Father, give me a heart, the heart of Jesus. Will anyone hear, anyone that hears my voice, will anyone help us save the children? Amen. Amen. It seems ironic. Listen to this. It seems ironic that everyone shows emotion and anger when children are shot, but seem to care less whether those children go to heaven or hell. Wake up, America. I believe you're on my side. I believe you have the vision and you're committing to mission. But I have to add, wake up America, to that I add, wake up River of Life Church. We are not doing enough, we have not done enough, and today it's time to be on mission in the vision and see the children saved in our communities. So who cares? But we care, we do care. 3 John in verse 4. I have no greater joy than to hear that my children are walking in the truth. If you want fulfillment in this life, and you want the joy of the Lord manifested in your life, and you want to do the will of God, and you want no greater joy, touch the children, save the children, reach out to the children. Feed them, bless them, clothe them, protect them, love them, teach them the Lordship of Jesus Christ. If you don't help save the children today, your children will grow up in a very strange world tomorrow. Can you capture what I said? I'm going to have to read it again. If you don't help save the children today, your children will grow up in a very strange world tomorrow. Save the children. Amen. Will anyone help us? Now, I'm asking, and I have to recruit before I can commission. And so this is about recruiting, because we are in planning stages, strategizing, working, pulling together, meeting together, praying together. Danny, thank you for your love, your support, your vision, and the call that you allow God to work through us, through you. And amen. We have to save the children. Will anyone help us save the children? Isaiah 6 and 8 said, then I heard the voice of the Lord saying, you're familiar with this. You've answered this before. Will you answer it again? Then I heard the voice of the Lord saying, whom shall I send and who will go for us? And I said, here I am, send me. Can you say, here I am, send me. Send me today. Send me now. Don't put it off. God, I want to go today. Help me save the children. Is there a man in this house who will say, I will go? Is there a woman in the house who will say, I will go? Is there a child in the house who will say, I will go? You can do it. Matthew 21, verse 15. But when the chief priests and the teachers of the law saw the wonderful things he did, and the children shouting in the temple area, "Hosanna to the Son of David," they were indignant. This was the chief priests, the teachers, the leaders. The children rose up, they got enthused, they got excited. But the leaders said no, and they became indignant, arrogant. What are some of the other words we could use? It was as though they hadn't done it, and if they didn't do it, they didn't want the children doing it. If they didn't do it, they didn't want someone else doing it. If the children did it first, then it made them feel ashamed. So instead of stepping into the vision and on mission, they became indignant as though this should never happen. And with showing contempt and disgust, this should not have happened. And they became indignant. I've been there when I was young. I've seen young people stepping in, stepping up. And I've seen some of them with so much energy, so much zeal. And they wanted, they may not have been doing it right, but they wanted to do it. And I've seen the ministry shut them down because it was as though it was requiring something of the leaders that they were not doing or did not have and the youth were wanting. And instead of encouraging the youth, realizing that God will call young people to change their generation. You see, we are to serve and change our generation, but when young people step up to lead and serve and save their generation, too many times they're put down. But they should be built up, they should be encouraged, they should be provided provision and encouraged and empowered to do what they're called to do. But yet we wonder, why aren't young people stepping into ministry? They may not get it right the first time. So many times they're getting it better than you did. Some of you. Not all of you. Maybe all of you. I don't know. I'm not trying to leave anybody out. I want to include you all. So maybe they're doing it better than all of you. So you're included, everyone. Let's save the children. Jesus said, "Let the little children come to me and do not hinder them. Do not hinder them. For the kingdom of heaven belongs to such as these." So I ask you, will you help save the children? Brooklyn, I appreciate you stepping into ministry to serve the children. Amen. She's young. She loves them. She has ideas. They're not my ideas. I've offered ideas, and she kind of looked at me funny, and I thought, oh, maybe I shouldn't have said that, you know. I like their ideas. Let's save the children. So I'm asking, can you help me before we close? Can you embrace this vision with me? Can you embrace it? Somebody says, how are we going to do it? I don't know, but we're going to do it. I don't have all the answers, but we're working on them. How are we going to save your children? Some of you, your children. How are we going to save your grandchildren who are not here? How are we going to do it? Help us embrace the vision. The commitment should be, how can I help? What can I do? I want to be involved. I want to do something. Well, we have a strategy. We're going to learn where they are and who they are. And we're developing. We're in developing stages right now because we want to launch forth a powerful ministry by the time that school starts. But we're not going to do, as they say, shoot from the hip. Shoot from the hip. You know, have you ever tried to hit a target by shooting from the hip? Some of you can, I know, but I do a whole lot better getting it in the sight. Getting it in the sight and hit the target. We want to get them in our sight and hit the target. So I'm not asking you to do more than you can. I'm not asking you to do more than you can. But I am asking you, I am begging you, I am asking you to do all that you can. All that you can. Not more than you can. Let's do all that we can. Save the children. Christina has a song. We'll have the words posted. A song that someone from the church where they were at in California wrote the words. And let's listen. You may want to sing. The words will be on the wall. Let me invite you to stand.
And what will they remember of the days of their youth? What will they remember of the time they had with you?
What do you remember when you were a child? I remember in the church just down the street here, past the center of town, in that old rock church. And there's some here this morning. You remember the same days, the same place. Going down to the altar and praying, the pastor praying with us, other folks in the church praying. We were teenagers. I remember Tammy when she was a teenage girl, younger than me, several years younger than me, my brothers and sisters. There were nine of us kids, and I remember my younger sisters laying in the floor just praying to God for sometimes an hour at a time. I remember the lady, I thought she was an old woman, but she wasn't much older than us. You know how kids are. And she would play and sing. I remember one time all the way through in that altar service, you've heard me mention this, all the way up to 1 o'clock in the morning as we were praying and seeking God. I remember those days as teenagers and the presence of God being there so strong and so mighty. They were teaching us the Word of God. They were teaching us how to walk in faith. They were letting us experience the power and the presence of God. There were so many prayers being prayed over us. And I remember as our experiences grew in the Lord, we continued seeking God after each evening service in fashions like that. Sometimes maybe 15 minutes, 30 minutes normal. An hour was not abnormal. Until we as young people began praying over one another. and experience the power of God working through us and ministering not just to us, but through us. Praying prayers of faith as we had prayed prayers of devotion and seeing lives changed and strengthened, ourselves being changed and strengthened over and over. What will they remember? What will our children, the children of our community, remember? What will they remember? I believe the time is short, but what if they grow old and have nothing to remember? Will you help us save the children? Christina, would you sing that again? God, let them see it in you. Let them see it in you. I love you. I appreciate you. Amen. Give him praise. Maybe that someone is here this morning that would like to accept Christ as your Savior. The way you accept him as your Savior is by making Jesus your Lord. If you'd like to accept him as your Savior, I would like to lead you in this prayer. And afterward, get with me. Visit with me a moment. Because we want to always help you to grow and continue to grow in the love and the grace of God, in the power of the Holy Spirit. Pray this prayer, if you would. Heavenly Father, I believe that you were God. I believe that you are the creator of heaven and earth, the God of eternity. I believe that you are the lover of my soul. I believe that Jesus Christ is your Son, your only begotten Son, whom you sent to this earth through Mary, a virgin. Jesus came as a baby and became a man until he gave himself as a ransom for my soul. By the shedding of his blood, he paid the price. By the death, he paid the price of my sin. By the shedding of the blood, he gave what was necessary to wash me and cleanse me and take my sin away. I accept Jesus as my Savior, and I make him my Lord. Jesus, you are my Lord. Father, I will serve you all the days of my life. Cleanse me from my sin. Wash me from every one of them. I pray, Father, that you would deliver me from my shame. Remove it, take it all away, and let the joy of the Lord be instored into my soul. Heal me from my pain, that which was imposed by others and that which I imposed upon myself. Heal me and deliver me. You are my God. Jesus is my Lord. I will serve you all the days of my life. And I say so as I pray so in Jesus' name. Amen, amen. If you believe that, give him praise. If you prayed that prayer, give him praise. And please come visit with me. Before E.T. steps up, we've asked Christina, if she would, to lead us in this song.
Amen. Let's sing this. God bless America. God bless America. Nice and low. Land that I love. Stand beside her. And guide her through the night.